Good morning, everyone. Myself Sushma. I'm a course instructor for subject of mobile computing. Right. In the previous class, we dealt with the limitations of mobile computing, as well as that we dealt with the applications of mobile computing and what is mobile computing. Right. So the basic concepts of mobile computing. So right, in today's session, we'll deal with the mobile computing architecture. So right, see here. So in mobile computing architecture, we are going to discuss what are all the basic programming languages we have in designing the mobile application, and what are all the network requirements, and what are the physical devices we need in order to design a mobile application. So while elaborating this, we'll be seeing the architecture of mobile computing, right? So this is the architecture for mobile computing. So before getting into this concept of mobile computing architecture, let us have an example example. So what happens whenever we are using a mobile phone? So initially, if you want to download a software, what you will do? You will go to the Play Store and directly install that application, right? So after installing that, whatever the icon you get, that is called as a application. So that is nothing but a client application. That is a client application. So what happens whenever you are working on that application is, it is going to interact, either it will be a communication GPI, that is, it means a messaging app. If it is a graphical user API, that means if it is going to provide you some things. So if it is a phone API, that means it is going to enable you with calls and messages. So next, middleware components. Is it a middleware component? So we'll see this middleware component in the further discussion. Okay. So client application, it may be either a communication API or GUI API or phone API. Okay. So what happens whenever you're working on this API is, you need to have some resources from the operating system. So this operating system will provide you how to you transfer the messages, and what are all the resources required for that application will be provided by the operating system. So these interconnection takes is connected with the operating system itself. So what happens is, it is going to give the resources to this application to run that application on the RAM. Okay. So now after the operating system, whatever the resources we get, we are using it, and if we want to transfer the data right now, so what happens? It will be taken by operating system, and this operating system is connected to a device hardware. So device hardware means it is connected to some memory. So inbuilt, our mobile phones come with some memory, right? So it is going to get connected with that hardware, and from that it is going to take the data and transfer that into the air as a medium, okay, and transfer those data to the receiver, okay, by using the air as a medium and transfer that data into the network. So this is the overview of this mobile computing architecture. So before getting this, we shall see what are all the different layers that are present in mobile computing architecture. So see that these are the basic steps that are involved in mobile computing. So first one is programming language, second one is functions of operating system, third one is functions of middleware for mobile system, fourth one mobile computing architecture, fifth one protocols, and sixth one is layers. So let us now discuss this one by one. First one, programming languages. So generally, whenever you are developing websites or blogs, you will be working with collections, swings, Java programs, and C hash, and Angular, Node.js, all these things, right? So whenever you're working on mobile applications, if you want to develop the mobile applications, what are all the programming languages you have is? So the first layer is programming languages. So in order to design the programming, mobile applications, we have a certain language called Java. So in this Java, we have three editions. So one is J2SC, and second one is J2EE, and third one is J2ME. So this J2ME is a micro edition that is used for designing the mobile applications. Okay. So with respect to this, this J2ME is used for designing applications for mobiles, whereas this Java card is used for designing the applications for smart cards. frameworks, we have certain frameworks called .NET and Python. So these are the Android supporting devices. But whenever you are coming to the Apple related, you have a separate language called Objective-C. So that particular language is used for developing applications for iOS. Okay. So the next layer is operating system. So let us now discuss what are the functions of operating system. So before getting to the functions of operating system, first of all, what is operating system? So operating system is a software which provides the resources to all the applications in the system. So the main part of the operating system is kernel. So this kernel is helpful in executing the tasks. So let us now discuss what are all the functions of operating system. So first one is user interface. If a user wants to download the applications, what does it need? Some resources. These resources are provided by the operating system. And next thing is, it needs to schedule the tasks in the system. So whenever we are working on the laptop or mobile phone, what happens? We'll be working with multiple applications simultaneously. So how to schedule these tasks will be taken care by the operating system. Okay. And next thing is peripheral management. What is meant by peripheral management? So peripheral management means inbuilt laptop or mobile comes with some internal memory. But if you want to extend that memory, you need to connect some external devices, right? So in order to work with that external devices, that peripheral management is taken care by operating system. Okay. With respect to this, it is also going to produce, give you some GUI. Now, with device drivers. So these are the functions of operating system. And next coming to middleware system for mobile system. So what is middleware? So middleware is a software component that connects applications with network distributed component. Okay. So what we are saying here, so this middleware is going to act as a mediator. Here the name itself indicates middleware. Middleware means mediator, right? So it is going to act as an interface in between operating system, next middleware, and applications. So generally, if you consider JDBC, one example for middleware component is JDBC ODBC driver. So what is JDBC ODBC? Java database connectivity and open database connectivity. So why we are using this? Whenever you work in 3-2 semester, whenever you work with database MySQL or Oracle databases PENGY version, you have a special driver called, whenever you install the software, it comes with a special driver called JDBC ODBC driver. This allows you to work with the databases. So this is one example for middleware. So JDBC exclusively works with pure Java. That means whatever the Java programs you have, those Java programs will be able to access the databases. And next one is open database connectivity. So what does this open database connectivity does? So it is going to use SQL syntax to proprietary formats. Okay, so by using these proprietary formats, that data, that query can be passed to the individual databases engines. So that is why we are going to call this JDBC ODBC as a middleware component. And next when we take the Bluetooth. So Bluetooth or some mobiles doesn't, or some laptops doesn't support Bluetooth. So then what we will do is we will install some device drivers. If we don't have LAN port, what we will do? We will use the device drivers for that USB LAN port too. Okay. So these are some of the examples for middleware components. And next coming to the architecture. So what is meant by architecture? Architecture is a systematic computations on a device, right? So what we are doing is, Here, all the devices are interconnected by using input-output interfacing. That means it can take either input or it can produce output also. That is why these layers are connected with input-output interfacing. So whenever the data is passed, it will be connected to the operating system, and from operating system it will be connected to the middleware layers, and from middleware layers, if at all it needs, it will be connected to the middleware layers. After that data will be directly passed into the network by taking the data from the hardware devices. Okay, so that is about the architecture. And next we shall see the protocols. So what is a protocol? So in order to communicate, so if I want to communicate with you, in what language I need to communicate? In English, as a professional, right? So the protocol between both of us is English. So here protocol means, in order to communicate between two different components, we need to have a certain regulations called protocols. Okay? So whenever you are connecting on LAN, you will have IEEE 802.11a and 11b. If you are working on PAN protocols, that means personal area networks, you will be having Bluetooth and ZigBee. Okay, and next thing is layers. So already we have seen the architecture. Those architecture layers are divided in based on the OSI layer reference model. So this OSI layer you have seen already in computer networks, where OSI stands for Open System Interconnection. So in this open system interconnection, you have 7 layers, right? Physical layer, data link layer, network layer, transport layer, session layer, presentation and application. So based on these 7 layers, the mobile computing architecture is divided into the same 7 layers. Okay, so where these 7 layers are used for transmission and reception of data streams. So this is about the mobile computing architecture, right? So the very next topic is mobile and handheld devices. So what is a mobile device? So mobile device means, I already told you in the previous session, where you will be able to carry your computing devices from one place to another place, and where they should be able to communicate with other devices. So that sort of devices are called as a mobile devices. Then what is handheld device? Okay, so what is handheld device? Handheld devices means only the smartphones we have, that comes under handheld devices. Mobile devices means the computing devices with that you are able to carry anywhere and do the processing are called as a mobile devices. So first concept is handheld mobile smartphones with multimedia functionalities. So whenever the smartphones are introduced, okay, recently we have a new era of smartphones, but previously 1990s we don't have this much capacity and this much requirements and this much features of smartphones, right? So what we had done is, when you see in this picture, so here we can will be able to see only the smartphone with only calling, music, video and some basic functionalities. But today smartphones comes with all the functionalities that are required for a person. Okay, so that is handheld devices, smartphones with multimedia functionalities, right? And next concept is smart cards. So what are these smart cards? So before letting into the concept, let me give you some example. So smart cards means whatever the ATM cards you carry, whatever the RFID cards you have. So smart cards are, the examples are ATM cards and RFID cards. These are the examples of smart cards. So now let us get into the concept. So smart cards means, so these are small pocket sized cards which has some processing capacity. Okay, so whenever you see the smart card, what happens here? There is a chip on this card. So whenever you insert this card into some electrical machine, it reads the data through this chip from the card and connects it to the server. So that means this is also a smart card which has some electronic processing unit that is embedded on the card. That is called as a smart card. Okay, so how this is going to work is, whenever this device is kept into the some ATM machine, automatically the signals will fall on this chip, and these signals will drag out some data from the card. Okay, whenever it is going to, then this data will be sent to the server. When that is identified or authenticated, automatically you will get some options to further do the transaction processing. So smart cards means that have electronic processing circuits. So these are some smart cards have rewritable memory device. That means whenever you insert the data into the card, you will be able to rewrite that memory. So for example, if you go to some shopping malls, what happens, they will give you some RFID cards on your shirts or your groceries. So what happens, whenever you tap on the reader, it immediately gets hooked from that cloth, and they will be throwing that effect. So it is a rewritable card. So what happens, what it is stored in that is the details of that particular fabric is stored. What is that fabric? What is the cost of that fabric? And how much length it is? All the basic details that are required. Is that have any offers or not? So based on this, if fabric is sale, what happens? They'll be using that for another fabric. That means those type of devices are cards are called as a smart cards, which are rewritable. Okay. So smart cards are of two types. One is contact smart cards and second one is contactless smart cards. So contact smart card means if it wants to read the data, it gets in touch with machine. Examples are ATM cards. Okay. And contactless smart cards. Contactless smart cards means whenever you are going to a software companies or some other companies, you will not scan the card by inserting it to the machine. Just you will show the card, okay? So as we are doing in our library, okay? So that is called as contactless. Directly you are not getting contact with the machine, just you are showing that card, okay? So that type of devices are called as contactless smart cards. So for these contactless smart cards or smart cards, we have three keys. One is fabrication key, personalization key, and utilization key. So fabrication key means, in order to identify a card uniquely, it is called as a fabrication key. So for example, if you take your ID card, so whenever you tap on the reader or when you show it to the reader, what happens? Will two cards have the same details? Obviously no. So whatever the key we are inserting, that is called as a fabrication key, which is used for identifying a card uniquely. And next one is personalization key. So personalization key means in order to activate host and server, we use a key called personalization key. If at all whenever we are doing some financial transactions in the ATM, what happens, we will enter our PIN. So by using that PIN, what happens, our card gets authenticated in the server and sends the response back to the host. That means you will be able to withdraw some amount from ATM. That sort of key is called as a personalization key. And the last, utilization key. Utilization key means it is used to unblock or lock the card. That is called as a utilization key. Okay. And next, what are the applications of these smart cards? These are used for financial transactions. As we have previously discussed, we will be using this for ATMs to withdraw or to do some transactions. And second one is personal ID and information. We are seeing it in reality in our college itself. And third one is to open security locks. So nowadays, as the locks are not that much safe, everyone is using digitalized locks. That means either you need to enter the PIN or you need to insert some card. Whenever you go to hotels, what happens? They will give you a RFID card such that it is going to, if we dip that card into the machine, then only it automatically opens the door. So for that sort of purposes, we will be using these smart cards as security locks. So these are the applications of smart cards. And next coming to smart sensors. So see this smart sensor. So what is a sensor? First of all, sensor means it is a physical device that has the capability to sense the physical environment. Whatever the environment we are facing, that is used, that will be sensed by the sensors. That sort of things are called as sensors. But then what is smart sensor? Where these sensors have computation. Computation, communication, capabilities. If the sensor has these two capabilities, it needs to do some processing and it should be able to transfer the data over the network. So if these have these two characteristics, these type of sensors are called as smart sensors. That means the smart sensors should have the ability to sense the physical environment, and at the same time they need to have computational and communication capability. So these sensors are called as a smart sensors. With respect to this, it needs to contain antennas for transmitting and receiving the signals, right? And these are generally programmed in assembly or C languages. So the example for this smart sensor is LDR, light dependent resistor. So what happens with this light dependent resistor is, if sunlight falls on this sensor, the light will be in off state. If darkness is present, it makes the light to glow in the darkness. So this type of sensors are called as a smart sensors. So overall, in this session we have dealt with mobile computing, mobile computing architecture, which consists of 6 layers, and second one is we dealt with mobile and handheld devices. In this we discussed handheld, smart cards, and third one is smart sensors. So this is the overall class we have discussed, and in the next session we will deal with handheld devices and limitations of mobile computing. Thank you.